We're really pleased to be publishing your recent research paper in Diabetologia in the August issue. And we also have that nice image of a Greenlandic dog sled on the cover to try to illustrate some of the research on exercise and diabetes in the Greenlandic population. So I just wanted to ask you, first of all, how do you go about conducting research in Greenland in terms of finding suitable participants and getting the community involved?
So this is a long-standing collaboration between the authorities at Greenland and also the Greenlandic Center. That's the Greenlandic Center for Health Research, but also the National Institute for Public Health here in Denmark. And they have for many years, since the 19th, performed health surveys in Greenland. So during these health surveys, early 90s, we were asked, at that time I was at Stinus Diabetes Center in Copenhagen, we were asked whether we would participate asking different scientific questions specifically related to genetics. So that was how it started. And then moving forward with several health surveys in Greenland, we have been part of that all the way. So when we're doing our research, it's also at the same time part of health survey.
That sounds very interesting. And do you have some Greenlandic researchers involved in the study also?
Yeah, so we try to collaborate close with the Greenlandic research communities. So for the actual research up there, there are translators, there are nurses, there are researchers also taking part of the health survey and interpreting data. For the genetic studies, where we are doing it mainly here in Denmark, we have some Greenlanders also involved in interpretation of the data. And then we are in close interaction with the Greenlandic health authorities, trying to be upfront communicating what we find back to the community.
And so the Greenlandic population live in quite a specific, different kind of environment, a very special environment. Is there much that you can learn about diabetes more generally from studying this unique population?
Yeah, definitely. So you're right, they are living in very different environments. So the larger cities is like in Europe, but then they are also living in smaller communities. And when we did the examination in the larger cities, we could put up an examination station as you would do in a large city here in Denmark, for example. But for the more rural areas, we have to visit by boat in order to examine them there. So that also means that they have a very different lifestyle, both in relation to exercise, but also to what they are eating. There are more and more Western diets because we can now transport all the food items to even the rural areas. But traditionally, for many, many thousand years, they have had less access to carbohydrates. So the diet has been very rich in protein and fat, primarily from fish and from sea mammals. And also with the changing environment, there's maybe less exercise nowadays because they also change from traditional hunting and fishing to more other kinds of work habits where exercise is less important. So there is a change in both lifestyle and then there's a unique genetic susceptibility to various diseases.
Yes, you mentioned the genetic susceptibility. So this particular paper that we're focusing on today looks at a gene called TBC1D4. Could you explain a little bit in a way perhaps that a non-scientist or a non-specialist could understand how you think that may be involved in diabetes?
Yes, so one of the advances studying an isolated genome like the Inuit genome, that is that many what we call large effect size variants, variation in the genome, which have a huge impact on the phenotype we are studying, they have a much higher frequency than in other populations. So around 6 years ago, we studied the impact of variation in the Greenlandic genome on 2-hour plasma glucose levels while after you have taken in a glucose drink. And there we found that one locus, one specific variation in the genome, in the gene called TPC1D4, that impacted the 2-hour glucose level very significantly. And this is a loss of function mutation, meaning that the protein is not, part of the protein is not expressed. So we immediately could get an understanding of what this genetic variant did. And the isoform proteins often exist in different isoform, but here was a long isoform, which we knew was primarily expressed in skeletal muscle. We also know after having a rise in glucose levels, for example, after ingesting a glucose-rich drink, then normally insulin will be secreted from the beta cell and insulin will bind to receptors on various tissues. And one of the most important tissues is skeletal muscle. And there insulin then signals throughout the muscle tissue to translocate so-called glucose transporters to the surface of the muscle. And then glucose is taken up. TPC1D4 is a very, very important signaling protein in the cascade of insulin signaling from the surface to GLUT4 translocation to the surface. And when you are lacking TPC1D4, you will not have insulin-stimulated glucose uptake in the muscle. So we immediately knew what was the cause of this hyperglycemia, high levels of blood glucose after intake of carbohydrates.
Well, that's very interesting. So you can see then how the glucose would increase in the bloodstream of people containing this variant. You have a mechanistic reason for why this gene is important. And have you seen mutations in this gene in other populations? Is this something that perhaps could be a more widespreadly linked to diabetes in a more widespread fashion?
So we have studied, and others has also studied, other Arctic population in Canada and in Alaska, and there the variant has been identified with the same frequency, high frequency, as we see in Greenland.
Oh, that's very interesting.
But outside the Arctic population, it is very, very rare, and it has not been described in European populations, for example, at all. Mm. I have had a contact to researchers in Japan, where they have observed 2 patients, heterozygous, only that one of their allele has the mutations, but otherwise it's very, very rare outside of the Arctic populations.
So the cause for the increases in type 2 diabetes among European populations may be due to something completely different, have a completely different genetic basis.
Definitely, it is another reason. And this, I think, illustrates that a lot of lessons could be learned comparing different populations.
Yes.
But often different populations don't have exactly the same genetic susceptibility for various diseases. And here we have an example that a population in the Arctic, they have a very high susceptibility for elevated glucose levels, which is a reason which is not found outside the Arctic. So here we should tailor maybe our preventive and treatment initiatives to that population.
Yes. Yes, no, that does sound.
And I think also studying different populations might learn us different things, which we might help us when we start looking at how to treat other populations. So I think for the TPC1D4, this very specific Arctic population form of diabetes, now we know that that we should, for example, not treat with insulin because insulin does not work at the skeletal muscle. But what we also learned is that they are responding very well to exercise. And we don't know exactly why they do this, but when we hopefully get more deep insight into these mechanisms, it might be lessons learned to apply in other populations. Mm. So this is what we hope both to give better advice and better treatment and prevention for the Inuit population, but also learn lessons to help other populations.
And you mentioned exercise. So, and you've obviously done some quite detailed questionnaires with the Inuit populations to asking them about their exercise habits. What are the most popular forms of exercise in these populations?
I cannot really, I don't have a survey on what the most popular form of exercise is, but what Greenlanders often does, that is going out to the nature. And they're going out to the sea and they're going out hunting. So the one kind of exercise, that is that they are walking and they're walking with various gear for being outdoors. And then, of course, they are also doing other forms of exercise, skiing and running and football, and that is the leisure time. And then in the working time, they also traditionally have a higher level of exercise than we do in Western countries. But the time are changing, so more and more Inuit, they are also maybe having a job where they are sitting next to them most of the day.
And I think that makes a difference, doesn't it? Whether you have exercise built into your day-to-day life or whether you have to actually plan to make time for exercise, it can make things
definitely
harder. So in terms of, you mentioned some of the cities in Greenland are changing and becoming more westernized. How do you think a typical rural Greenlandic person would fare if they moved to a very westernized city such as Copenhagen? Or
so there are many Greenlanders living in Copenhagen and Denmark. So we have had a tradition for a close relationship for many hundred years. They will cope very well, but we know that there are these genetic variations, for example, handling a Western diet, which is different from handling their traditional diet. Yes. So some individuals, for the TBC1D4, it will be around maybe 3-4% of the population. They will then have, when they eat carbohydrates, they will have a elevated and prolonged phase of high glucose levels. But then they will drop down to basic levels again. And next time they eat carbohydrates, it will be the same elevated and prolonged level of glucose.
Oh, that's interesting. So it's good to think about having that understanding, which helps us know best how to treat people and help them. And then in terms of exercise, for those of us that live a sedentary lifestyle and we work in front of our computers and we're not out in nature all the time, what kinds of exercise do you think are the best ones for helping improve glucose regulation and preventing diabetes?
I think that's a very difficult question. And actually, I think it will also be individual and I think exercise is important for all of us. And if you have problems with doing exercise, then just walking and quick walking has been shown to be very, very efficient for type 2 diabetic patients. But if you are into more sports, then running and bicycling would also be very good.
I suppose the question is to find the thing you like doing and then to do it and not make excuses.
Exactly. Exercise is number one, and then do what you like.
Yes. Well, very good. Well, thank you very much. I think that we've covered a lot of ground here, and it's been really, really interesting to talk to you and get a little bit of a wider picture on your research.
Thank you too.